From the germ of an idea to a full-grown article, comic, or video, a lot goes on behind the scenes here at Knowable Magazine. It all starts with an idea, something timely, interesting, and important. Maybe it's a question we've been pondering or something a reader asks. Often it's inspired by an article from our parent organization, Annual Reviews, the nonprofit publisher of over 1,000 scholarly reviews every year on everything from microbiology to sociology to particle physics. After making some important decisions, we assigned the story to one of our seasoned science journalists, many of whom originally trained as scientists. The writer interviews multiple experts on the topic and carefully shapes the story. Next comes edits, asking questions, rearranging information, smoothing, fiddling, and pruning. Back and forth from editor to writer it goes until everything's there and in the right place. A fact checker then scrupulously verifies every word, from the color of a scientist's armchair to the mass of a subatomic particle. After any needed changes, it's off to the copy editor, who flags issues with grammar, tone, or flow, ensures that the style is consistent, and crafts a compelling headline. All the while, our art director is researching, designing, and commissioning the infographics, photos, and illustrations that give a story visual sizzle. Then it's publication time. With a final check, the digital producer compiles all these elements and brings the story online. All this work ensures that every story has the Knowable stamp: smart, trustworthy, timely, and compelling. And it doesn't end there. Our stories are free for everyone to read, share, republish, and enjoy, bringing fact-based science stories to curious minds all around the world. To make this all happen, we need your support. Head to knowablemagazine.org/donate and become a sustaining donor today.
Hello, and welcome everyone. This is The Psychology and Politics of Conspiracy Theories. I'm Rachel Ehrenberg. I'm an editor at Knowable Magazine from Annual Reviews. This is the 12th event in Reset, our series of conversations about the pandemic, its consequences, and the way forward. We also have a second event today, beginning right after this one, on making scientific knowledge available to everyone. It will feature 3 one-to-one conversations between noted virologist Harmeet Malik, IPCC climate scientist Diana Erga-Forsitz, and Knowable's own executive editor, Rosie Mestel. They will take questions too, and I think it's going to be a fascinating discussion on a topic that's really important to all of us. This event is also free to attend, but it does require a separate registration, so we've dropped a link in the chat box. And the registration is also now open for our November event, which will dive into virus variants, COVID, but also the flu and others. We'll drop a link to register for that one into the chat box as well. Today, now, I'm very excited to learn more about conspiracy theories. They've had a big impact on politics and public health in the past year. And while it may seem like they're favored by one end of the political spectrum more than another, no one is immune. I learned that reading a terrific story by our moderator today, Greg Miller. Greg is a contributing editor to Knowable Magazine, and we're very happy to have him here today leading this discussion. Over to you, Greg.
Okay. Thanks, Rachel, and thanks everybody for joining us. I think it's going to be a really interesting discussion, and we have a lot of ground to cover. As Rachel said, conspiracy thinking seems to be all around us recently. We've seen throughout the pandemic conspiracy theories circulating about the virus and about the vaccines. We've seen the role they played in the aftermath of the 2020 election here in the U.S. And the attacks on the Capitol in January. And I think closer to home, many of us in our social media feeds and conversations with friends and family probably know people in our own lives who've gone down the conspiracy rabbit hole. I know I do. And I wrote a story for Knowable earlier this year because I was really interested in the psychological underpinnings of conspiracy theories, what makes them so appealing, and also on the impact that they seem to be having on our political institutions and our society. And we're lucky today to have two really great people here joining us to discuss this. They come at the issue from different perspectives. Nancy Rosenblum is a political theorist who specializes in historical and contemporary political thought. She's a professor emerita at Harvard University and co-author of a 2019 book, A Lot of People Are Saying, The New Conspiracism and the Assault on Democracy. Sander van der Linden is a social psychologist at Cambridge University. His research focuses on human judgment, communication, and decision-making, and he frequently advises governments and social media companies on how to fight misinformation, including but not limited to conspiracy theories. And both of them, I should add, are joining us today under challenging circumstances. Nancy has a power outage where she lives, and Sander is technically on paternity leave. So thank you both very much for being here, especially under the circumstances. Nancy, I'll start with you. So in one of the things that surprised me most in researching my story was just the long history that conspiracy theories have in U.S. politics. And you write in the book that even the Declaration of Independence, the sort of founding document for our country, is based on a conspiracy theory. Can you say a little bit about that? What exactly was the conspiracy there?
Yes, that's right, Greg. The United States was born of a conspiracy theory. So if you read the Declaration of Independence on July 4th, you're familiar with conspiracism in its classic form. We value the Declaration for its aspirational, we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. But for the framers, the truth of the conspiracy directed against the colony's basic liberties was not self-evident. And so they had to lay out the evidence scrupulously in a list of 20 grievances that make up the bulk of the Declaration. The most familiar is probably is no taxation without representation. So in the Declaration, a series of actions taken by the Crown and his ministers and Parliament and the colonial governors were the dots that once put together formed a pattern that added up, in John Locke's famous phrase, to a long train of abuses and usurpations, all tending the same way, to reduce the colonies to absolute despotism. So which is to say that you put together all of these dots to form the pattern, and then you see that a tiny tax on tea is not just a tiny tax on tea, but a fatal precedent, the thin edge of a wedge of despotism. And the Declaration also directs a course of action. There could be no redress of grievances or reconciliation. They had to resolve to dissolve the political bounds that bound them to Britain by armed resistance and to declare themselves independent states. So the Declaration is a fully articulated classic conspiracy theory. If I could just add one caution that I think is necessary. We use the phrase conspiracy theory today as if it's false by definition, but some conspiracy theories really are true. Whether the Declaration is true or not, or was accurate or not, is a real question. I sometimes imagine that I would have been a loyalist exiled to Canada. But some conspiracy theories really do identify covert corruption and treachery. The progressive movement in the United States at the turn of the century found smoke-filled rooms and corporate boardrooms, and it led to radical democratic reforms. And Exxon Fuel did alter the data about fossil fuel and climate change to become what my colleague Naomi
Nancy, are you still there?
I'm here.
Okay.
Can you see me or hear me?
Sorry, no, I was just saying, since your communication situation is a little perilous, maybe we should, I'll stick with you for another question, and then we'll come back to Sander. But
okay.
in the book, you write that, you were talking about how you're saying now that the Declaration of Independence is kind of based on a classic conspiracy theory, but in the Trump era, you argue that we've seen a new type of conspiracism. What have you seen there?
Right. Well, what we've seen in the United States is what we call conspiracy without the theory. It too insists that things are not as they seem, but it dispenses entirely with the burden of evidence. There's no exhausting amassing of facts, no signs that reveal a pattern, no interpretation, no argument. It takes the form of bare assertion. You've heard Trump say many, many times, the election is rigged. Just one word suffices to charge that the presidential primary or the presidential election was manipulated without any reports of fraud on the voters. And so he says that about the 2016 election and 2018 midterms, that undocumented immigrants vote many, many times. And so then the question is, if rigged, to take the example, is not accompanied by any evidence or argument, what gives this conspiracy without any theory its power and appeal? I mean, after all, thousands of political lies come and go. They're fact-checked, or they're filed away, or they fade away. But conspiracist claims have a very long half-life. And I think that several things make them politically important. The first is that bare assertion, saying something is a hoax or rigged, even without rudimentary evidence, is easy to communicate, even in 280 characters on Twitter. And it's a very gratifying form of aggression to claim rigged or hoax or traitor. And the regular rhythms of democratic politics don't offer this kind of emotional relief. Neither does the complexity of real conspiracy theory. And conspiracy theory without the theory has this characteristic too. What validates it, if not argument, is just repetition. You've heard the mantra, you know, a lot of people are saying that, and a lot of people are saying bad things. Social media allows this. It allows anyone to speak to everyone instantly and cautiously, but it has a special value for conspiracism because likes and shares and tweets and retweets are measurable. We don't have to verify substantive claims, but we can verify that a lot of people are saying that there's something going on here. And as a matter of fact, that's how Senators Cruz and Hawley justified the attempt to overturn the Electoral College results after the 2020 election. It was enough to say, and I'm quoting here, by any measure, the allegations of fraud and irregularities exceed any in our lifetime. And the other thing, the final thing really that makes this so powerful is that subscribers to these conspiracy claims don't have to believe the particulars. It's not really a matter of believing the fact of the matter, nor of repeating it while believing that it's false. It's true enough. And true enough means that the accumulation of objective evidence is not necessary to warrant the claim, because the claim carries a deeper truth that goes beyond any kind of evidence that might be required. So when conspiracist claims are challenged, we see that true enough is the official response. I remember very early on that when President Trump tweeted a video that falsely purported to see a migrant Muslim committing an assault, his press secretary, Sarah Huckabee Sanders, offered the deeper truth claim. She said, well, whether the video is real, the threat is real. True enough floats conspiracies in them, even as it corrodes what it would mean to know, for example, whether this Muslim immigrant committed an assault. And so tweeting and posting and liking and sharing, the aggression, the repetition, the deeper truth, also signal to people their identification with others. And this is what takes conspiracism out of the realm of individual psychology and into politics. Because to supporters, the bottom-up repetition of a conspiracy charge is not only proof that a lot of people are saying it, but it's the signature of a new collective we. And the act of repetition is, I think, the first step on the path to malignant action in the world.
And you think this is having a real impact on our political institutions and society?
But it goes beyond my thinking that. I think that there are devastating consequences for democracy in America and likely other places as well. And let me just stick to one because it's so familiar to people. Democracy doesn't secure the peaceful transition of power. It presupposes it. And democracy rests on a system of regulated party rivalry in which the political opposition is recognized as legitimate opposition. Now, this is an extraordinary historical achievement because it means that partisans, political actors, are committed to political pluralism. And I think it requires a real kind of personal moral discipline to recognize that your party, as the term party suggests, is just a part, and it's not going to be able to claim to represent all real Americans or Hungarians for that matter. And so legitimate opposition is not just an idea, but a practice that's carried out whenever winners of an election refrain from using their power to harass or intimidate or humiliate or jail or exile or murder the opposition. It's really right to say that democracy depends on the losers as well as the winners. And what we've seen here is the delegitimation of opposition coming in stages, and each stage is based on a conspiracy claim that Obama, for example, was not a natural-born citizen, that the Democratic Party is held hostage by far-left activists and angry mobs and Antifa and deep state radicals, so that if they're elected, we won't have a country anymore. So we begin to see that the big lie about the rigged 2020 election was really two big lies, because it followed years of characterizing the political opposition as a public enemy. And it allowed finally for the claim that the insurrection took place on November 3rd, on election day, that January 6th was just a protest. And I want to make one thing clear in talking about the delegitimation, in this case of a party system, is that delegitimation is not just sowing mistrust or doubt or discrediting the opposition. To delegitimate a party or the press or a knowledge-producing institution is to drain it of all meaning and value and authority, so that it can no longer claim our consent or our compliance. And this, I think, is conspiracy's distinctive work in politics, to delegitimate these key democratic institutions. And I think it's a glide path to harassments and threats and violence, not just on January 6th, but now every day against ordinary officials going about the ordinary business of governing.
Sandra, I want to turn to you. I know there's a long current of debate and discussion about whether conspiracy thinking is more prevalent on the political right or the left, and I'm curious to hear your take on this body of research.
Yeah, it's clearly a complex issue. Some would even say a politicized issue, You know, in our research, we try to step back and be as neutral as we can about this question. And so you have to raise the question of, is there something that's unique about the brain or the psychology of conservatives versus liberals that makes one side more susceptible or interested in endorsing and spreading conspiracy theories? And there are some clues as to why that might be the case. And so one issue is that you could argue, for example, that it's just a function of the political climate. So maybe it appears as if people on the political right, and when I say political right, I mean extreme right mostly, are spreading more conspiracy theories because there's a lot going on at the moment that's congenial to extreme right-wing populist movements. And so in another time and place, and another point in history, maybe it would have been extreme left-wingers, right? That is just a function of who's in government, what's the current situation. Another methodological problem, you know, when we do this kind of research is, and this is maybe helpful for the audience, a typical conspiracy study will include a scale asking you to what extent do you believe in a series of conspiracy theories? Do you think the government's hiding aliens? Do you think that vaccines are a plot to inject microchips into our bodies? To what extent do you believe that the moon landing was a hoax? And what we do is we generalize conclusions based on the average indicator of you know, to what extent people endorse these items. But what we discovered, and a lot of research does this, most research does this, what we discovered is that you can't really say anything about the role of politics in this, because the items that comprise the scale are ideologically slanted in and of themselves in unpredictable ways. So some researchers will use a scale with mostly right-leaning conspiracy theories. Some researchers will use a scale that has a lot of left-leaning conspiracy theories. Some use a mix of both, but it's unbalanced. And so that led us to conclude that actually you can't really say much about the role of politics when you do that. So instead, what we did in our research was, are there new scales, newer ways of measuring belief in conspiracy theories that do not ask people about any specific conspiracy theory, so it's content-free, but it does get at the underlying thinking pattern that is characteristic of conspiratorial reasoning? And so let me give you an example of scales that have been devised to measure this. Instead of asking you about a specific conspiracy, I would just ask you, do you think it's likely that people are plotting in secret, people are devising plans in secret to dupe people? Do you think the government is often hiding things from people? Do you feel that, you know, there are things happening behind the curtains that you're not privy to that are dangerous for society? And so it just gets at this sort of underlying suspicion that evil people are plotting something in secret. And so that is one of the skills that we decided to use. And then if you look at theory, there are good reasons to assume why there would be a difference between liberals and conservatives or people on the right and the left. So one of those differences, if you look at, you know, decades of research on the psychology of liberals and conservative belief systems, you find that they express different values, different interests, different motives. So, you know, people on the political right prefer to affiliate with like-minded people more than liberals. Liberals tend to affiliate with people who are different from them. So this is a preference in a type of social interaction that people have. Conservatives do not like social change very much. They like stability, right? Traditionalism, whereas liberals prefer radical change. Conservatives don't like uncertainty. Liberals are better with tolerating uncertainty. And the reason why these differences between liberals and conservatives are relevant is because the function of a lot of conspiracy theories is pretty uniform in the sense it tries to reduce uncertainty for people. It gives people a sense of control by making the narrative very, very certain and saying, oh, these are the people, these are the actors, right? There's a connection here. It's often a way to avoid change. Oh, if global warming is a conspiracy, I don't have to do anything about it, right? And so there are a lot of reasons why conspiracy theories in their design appeal more to the sets of psychological preferences that people on the right tend to espouse more so than people on the left. And what you then get is also, if you look at the history of a lot of conspiracy theories, they tend to be very popular about demonizing outgroups, minorities, themes that resonate more with the political right than the political left. And so putting that all of that together, and in fact, there's a really, you know, popular book from Richard Hofstadter, who's a historian, called the Paranoid Style in American Politics, which kind of dictates a long history of paranoia in the US political system about other groups of people that sort of plays into this. And so from a theoretical angle, there's this good reason to assume that there might be such a difference. And then we use these sort of new scales that are as neutral and unbiased as possible to see what's happening. Now, I should caveat here, very important, I am not saying that liberals do not endorse conspiracy theories. I mean, that's clearly not the case. I mean, there are liberals who endorse conspiracy theories, right? That's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is that if you look at the spectrum, then at the extreme ends, we would expect that extreme conservatives are more inclined towards the conspiratorial sort of way of thinking than extreme liberals, because there's something unique about that psychology that relates to that type of thinking. So it's not, I mean, again, so this is not saying that liberals do not endorse conspiracy theories, but that there's this asymmetry, this asymmetry that causes a preferential treatment to conspiracy theories because it's more congenial to the conservative sort of set of values. And again, it's complex because I don't want to, you know, conservatives are a heterogeneous group of people. Now, more so than in the past, we see a more radical form of conservatism that's sometimes called pseudo-conservatism, that real conservatives, traditional conservatives, wouldn't endorse the type of values that we're currently seeing because it goes against the sort of mild temperament and compromising position of the conscientious traditionalist. But, you know, just tabling that discussion for a moment, what we found is when you administer these scales, not referencing any particular theory, conservatives, extreme conservatives, were more likely than extreme liberals to score higher on these scales. And we found that in nationally representative studies time and again, so not just on specific issues where you would expect it, like global warming, because that's polarized in the US, but we also found it on these scales that don't mention any specifics. And further, what we found was that this appears to be the case, and this is maybe the more interesting thing, that conservatives also scored higher on distrust of official sources and institutions and higher on paranoia. So a paranoid ideation scale are things like, I feel that I'm being followed all the time. And so what you see is that if there's a heightened state of paranoia and distrust, that's a gateway to being open and susceptible to conspiracy theories. And that gateway exists maybe because a lot of conspiracy theories play into the types of themes that resonate more with the psychology of extremists on the right than extremists on the left. And there's some evidence that moderate people are less on both sides are less likely to endorse conspiracy theories, but that's, you know, that's sort of what the research showed.
I'm wondering also about the role of emotion and the appeal of conspiracy theories, just in reading some of the news that's come out in the last few weeks about Facebook and how they game their algorithm to push bump up posts that elicit angry emoji. And it does seem like there's something about a lot of conspiracy, at least the conspiracy theories we see now, that are just invoke a sense of injustice and anger. And I'm wondering if there's research that bears that out, the role of emotion in the appeal of conspiracy theories for people.
Yeah, well, one of the things we found by analyzing the language that real conspiracy theorists on Twitter, I can't name them because of ethics applications, but we looked at the top conspiracy people on Twitter, and then we analyzed the emotionality of the language that they use in their tweets and also of a group of their followers. And one of the things that we found is that they're much higher on negative emotion, particularly anger and anxiety, in spreading their message. So a lot of conspiracy theories are about fear, and often fear about other groups of people or events. So that's definitely a factor that aids in the spreading of conspiracy theories, because you don't only see it among the influencers, but also among the followers. And so there's a likelihood that that type of language is being adopted. Because, you know, when there's a certain political climate and you see popularity of conspiracy theories go up and down, because, you know, in times where there's no social unrest, when there's no political unrest, people in general are less likely to endorse these type of explanations. But, you know, when there's a lot of uncertainty, when there's a lot of fear going on, they really play into that narrative by appealing to these type of negative emotions. And so that definitely plays a role. The other thing is that conspiracy theories that nobody care about aren't that popular. And so, you know, okay, there's aliens in Area 51. And I guess there was some recent news on that, you know, but for a long time, nobody really cared about that. Whereas the satanic pedophile ring that, you know, QAnon followers are really concerned about, you know, that's the type of moral injustice stuff that really gets people riled up. And you're right to mention the Facebook study, which, you know, the documents revealed that angry emotions were weighted five times the value of a like, for example, or emotions in general, I should say, which includes angry emotions, which was the most popular one. And that kind of jives with other research we did on social media, where we found that any post is more likely to be shared on social media if you mentioned the other groups, or if you're a liberal and you're talking about conservatives and vice versa, but particularly when it's negative. So basically when you're dunking the other side, that's the type of stuff that goes viral on these platforms. That's what we found in our study. And initially, Facebook came out saying that that's not true with a press statement saying that they don't deliberately do this. But it's interesting that these documents have now revealed that there were, in fact, upweighting negative sort of emotional reactions.
Let me go back to you. When we spoke last year about the impact of conspiracism on our political institutions, we, or at least I, had no idea what was yet to come with the election and the insurrection. What are you thinking now? You weren't particularly optimistic at the time about the yeah. outlook for undoing some of the damage, but what's your current thinking?
Before I just answer that, let me just respond a bit to what Sander said, because his work is very important, but he just began to get at the questions that for political people really matters, which is how do we get from an individual mindset to a collective conspiracist mindset, especially one where you truly identify with this we, and then how do you get to one that's politically potent? What makes it so politically powerful that it's shaping politics today? So QAnon, for example, is important not because it's about moral injustice, but because it is an apocalyptic vision of what you do about a political enemy, in this case, a partisan political enemy. What changed since 2020, Greg? 2020 wasn't a repeat performance of other conspiracy claims in the United States, including, you know, the 2016 election was rigged. And everything changed, and here's my addition to the point I just made. Everything changed because as a president, Trump, with a conspiracist mindset and a compromised sense of reality, really could use the tools of government he had them in his hands. He could have his postmaster general slow down the delivery of mail-in ballots. And this became a model for what state governors and legislators could do to exploit the stolen election lie. I think there's a second change besides that cataclysmic one, which was that we had a conspiracist as president and a submissive political party, is that the simple assertion rigged, the conspiracy without the theory, began to be embellished. And now you do have worked out convoluted conspiracy theories about why these elections are rigged. You have dots and patterns and evidence and argument. And they're worked up by conspiracy entrepreneurs, and they're financed by national organizations and wealthy conservatives. So in the state of Arizona, which had this cyber ninja firm showing what was wrong with the Arizona election, the conspiracy theory adds to, at least for many people, the potency of the claim of rigged. And I think this matters because political officials, national, state, and local, are really, most of them, more comfortable with this explanation for why the election was rigged than sheer assertion that I won in a landslide. It is unclear to me, though, if convoluted conspiracy theory about the elections, for example, makes a difference to the 61% of Republicans who think the election was stolen, or whether they're perfectly happy to continue on with just the exclamation rigged. If I can, I want to speculate about something else I think seriously important that may have been changing over the last few years and that has come out now, Greg, and that is, I think there's an emergent radical change in the fact that many citizens really no longer care about governing or about government outcomes. That the interests that are driving these conspiracists, who are often now violent and armed, are not rooted in policy preferences, which is what political scientists used to typically think about in a democracy. I think that they're mobilized instead by a kind of populist fantasy of rule, by someone who's very powerful, who promises to destroy the people and institutions that frustrate and humiliate them. And I think that maybe the decisive element behind what I see as a growing indifference to governing and to the policies that government produces, is the realization that really no law or no policy and no administrative action can deliver what seems to be desperately wanted on the right today. And that is a reinstatement of white supremacy by law, or ensuring the permanency of one party rule and their cultish leader. And that's why I think that an attempted coup, and for that matter, rogue violence, is not safely in the past, but coming up. I'd say one other thing here about conspiracism today, and that is some conspiracy theories have been utopian, like the Revolutionary Republic that we talked about in the Declaration, and some are murderously apocalyptic. I think that's true of QAnon's storm, where from the apocalypse a phoenix is going to rise from the ashes. But I think that the conspiracism that's active in politics and party politics in the United States today is without a program. It's without ideology. I think it's sterile. I think it can't create or build or reform. All it can do is destroy. And it's destroying conservatism along with everything else. And that's why I say that these conspiracist charges today are D all the way down. They're destabilizing and degrading and delegitimating and ultimately violent.
This is discouraging to hear. It also is discouraging to me just how difficult it seems to be to once people go down that rabbit hole of conspiracy thinking to turn them around. And I know, Sandra, you've done some research on interventions, and I'm hoping you can tell us something and maybe have some good news.
Well, I mean, yes. I mean, I think there's good and bad news. I mean, there is, as you say, once people go down the rabbit hole, it's very difficult to address the issue. And that's why I think the current tools that we have, like fact-checking and debunking, aren't enough. Because once people become enthralled in it, they don't want to let go. And so one approach that we focused on is something called prebunking, which is the opposite of debunking. And it's based on a psychological theory called inoculation theory. And the idea behind psychological inoculation is that you try to prevent these ideas from taking hold in people in the first place. And the way to do that, paradoxically actually, is to expose people to a weakened dose of misinformation or conspiracy theory so that people can build up cognitive or mental antibodies against them. So, right, the idea of a vaccine is that, you know, it trains your cells to recognize foreign invaders by injecting a weakened dose, an attenuated dose of the virus. And you can do the same with information. So in our studies, and we've done lots of these, when we expose people to a weakened dose of a conspiracy theory and then subsequently refute that theory in advance, people become more resistant to these types of explanations in the future when they're being confronted with them. And one of the ways I think that we've found this to be useful for the wider public is through interactive interventions. So for example, we've produced games that simulate a social media environment and not only warn people about the dangers of conspiracy theories in advance, but also allow people to experiment with the ingredients of a conspiracy theory. And so the idea is similar to, you know, once you know how the sausage is made, you don't really want to eat it anymore. And so the idea is the same, that we put people in a sandbox and we allowed them to experiment with weakened doses of the people who produce conspiracy theories and what goes into it. And then we test people. You know, we bombarded them right after, but also weeks later, with all kinds of crazy conspiracy theories. And we found that people, you know, have built up, quote unquote, antibodies against these sort of theories, that they now find them less reliable, less accurate, and are less willing to share them because they're able to recognize the manipulation tactics that are used in the production of conspiracy theories. And so that idea of inoculation has been quite powerful, because there's a lot to say about prevention is better than cure in this context.
And to what extent does this work? Like, how effective do you think this can be?
Well, I mean, I think the idea of inoculation, the idea of a vaccine at the individual level, I think is I mean, it's useful, but I think ultimately for me, the real power of the metaphor needs to drive home the biological analogy to its logical conclusion, which is herd immunity. And so I think for it to only be, effective at a societal scale, I think we need to be able to scale this idea of the vaccine. And so the games are fun, and millions of people go through our interventions, but there's billions of people in the world, right? And we can't vaccinate everyone. And again, it's not the approach that we've taken here is you can vaccinate people against a specific conspiracy theory by preemptively refuting the basis of that theory rather than after the fact. That's possible. That's what we call an issue-based inoculation. But the approach we've taken, which we call a technique-based inoculation, is to expose the manipulation techniques that are part of conspiratorial reasoning in a larger sense, because that avoids having to discuss specific facts with people. And so instead of saying you're wrong, you need to believe this or that, we're not saying anything about what people need to believe. We're just exposing the tactics of deception for people, and then people can make up their own mind. And that's been helpful in scaling this and not having this intervention become politicized. But we've produced various versions of these games, and we've teamed up with the government in the UK, government in the US during the election. We've trialed it with the World Health Organization. It was part of the Stop the Spread campaign. We've worked with the United Nations. We've worked with social media companies like WhatsApp and Google on building this out, doing videos and all kind of animated videos on YouTube, all kinds of new ways of trying to implement this idea. For example, this is not currently happening because we have to deal with the executives of social media companies who aren't always immediately pushing these interventions through. But imagine that you're on YouTube, and before you're exposed to a conspiratorial video, you're watching an ad, one of those annoying non-skippable ads, but now the ad is the pre-bunk. And so the YouTube algorithm can identify with some probability if the video is going to be, harmful, and then it could automatically inject the antidote before people see it, for example. And so then you can scale this idea across millions of people. And so that's the kind of the line of reasoning that we're currently pursuing. I should say it's not like a biolo it's not like 95% efficacy like the Pfizer vaccine, right? It's a relatively modest boost in people's attitudes. It wears off over time, so you might need to boost people, just as with the COVID vaccine. But it's a useful step, I think, in the right direction and part of the toolbox, because fact checking and debunking are clearly not enough, and so we need to take some of these preemptive steps. And I think that's kind of the value of the metaphor.
Okay, great. Well, I want to leave a little bit of time for questions. We're getting some questions, and I want to thank everyone again for tuning in. And if you're enjoying this event and want to join future ones, please be sure to sign up for Knowable's newsletter. We'll drop the link in the chat box, and also you can follow Knowable on Facebook and Twitter for updates. Those links will be in the chat as well. And we're able to offer this event for free thanks to philanthropic support. And if you would like to become a supporter of Knowable, you can head to knowablemagazine.org/donate. So thanks again, everybody. And let's look at some questions. So we're getting a lot of questions, I guess not surprisingly, about the role of social media in fostering and amplifying conspiracy theories, and people are curious about, I guess, your views on what the government could and should be doing to regulate big tech, and also at a sort of mechanistic level, what actually could be done, like what would that look like in practice? Maybe Sandra, do you want to start, since you've worked with social media companies? Do you have thoughts on that?
Sure. Yeah, I think my experience it has been that as Francis was saying during her testimonies here in the UK actually this week, some of the a lot of the employees are well-intentioned and they want to address the problems and they make note of these things, but they're not being heard by management. They're not being heard by the executives, and I think the problem is that the solutions that exist or that are offered often come at the cost of decreasing engagement on the platform. And that means less ads, lower profits, and so that's not being implemented. I think ultimately we're going to have to accept the harsh reality, or these companies are going to have to accept the harsh reality that some of the interventions that they're going to need to implement mean that they're going to make potentially less money and see lower engagement on the platform. And maybe that's not a bad thing. I mean, they're always in the mindset that there's going to be a solution that doesn't hurt engagement and solves the problem at the same time. But I think, you know, it might be that, I'm not sure if that's really attainable. I think at some point we're going to have to just fundamentally restructure how social media works. I mean, if you want my personal opinion, I think we should restructure the incentives on social media. I think one of the problem incentives on social media is that negative conversations are being prioritized. There's a lot of out-group derogation. There's a lot of hatred. Social media was potentially designed to keep people connected for positive social conversations and so on, and it's turned into a cesspool of very negative things at the moment. And so what I think we need to do is incentivize essentially things that bring out the best in people, you know, constructive conversations, evidence-based conversations, accuracy-oriented incentives. So what are the things that want to make people be accurate, maybe even moderate, not political? And those things don't get a lot of engagement, right? It's more boring. Science is not as exciting as a big argument on social media. And so they'll see less engagement. And frankly, social media companies have said straight up that they're not, you know, the goal of social media is not to promote evidence-based conversations. The goal is to promote any type of conversation people want to have. You know, they're free to do what they want on the platform, as so long as they don't violate the user policies. And I think as long as they have that philosophy, we're not going to see any useful change.
Nancy, do you have thoughts on this, the role of social media and the potential for regulation as a solution?
I don't want to talk about regulation as a solution. I really am quite ambivalent about government regulation of these things. But I do want to say that while it's very clear that social media is enabling and a serious factor in the spread of conspiracism, I don't think it's the cause of it. And I think that what we should be worried about as well is, as I say, conspiracism when it enters the realm of politics and society, that is conspiracism, once it's in action, once these people are mobilized and often armed and out there voting and taking other kinds of, and taking some sorts of quite destructive actions. And there, I think that the answers are not just controlling what goes on in social media, but other kinds of actions that democracies require. I mean, it requires speaking truth to conspiracism, especially from political leadership. And whether that changes people's minds or not, it does, that is conspiracist minds or not, it does give a kind of moral buttress to those people who want to oppose it. I think that the second thing that I would recommend here is enacting democracy, and that is what's going on right now under this new administration, where the assumption is that people will be reconciled to democracy and politics and winning and losing if they think that government is providing for them in certain ways. And I think that the Biden administration has taken this on very seriously, that if we're not going to have a further degradation of political life in the United States, they have to produce things for people, goods and benefits and so on. I think that today one of the most important obstacles or answers to conspiracism is going on in that beating heart of democracy, which is in civil society, where we see all kinds of organized groups and associations and mobilized people and legal actions and so on and so forth that are challenging the politics of this and the effects of the politics of this. But I think that in the end, so long as you have political leadership and one of the two major political parties devoted to using conspiracism to exercise and keep power, it's going to be very hard to stop.
Here's another question. Seems interesting. So, someone's asking, are conspiracy theories more abundant in democratic societies or authoritarian societies? And I guess I would even broaden that a little bit to ask whether there are certain cultural or societal conditions that allow conspiracy theories to flourish. Anyone?
I don't know the answer to where they're more prevalent. From what I read and know, they can be used politically anywhere by everyone, and are. And the one thing I think I've observed, and although I haven't done a study of it, I've observed, is that in the past, American conspiracists often imported conspiracy theories from Europe and from abroad. Protocols of the Elders of Zion, for example, or certain kinds of anti-communist conspiracies. But today it seems to be reversing and we're exporting them. And we have a lot of evidence in regimes in Eastern Europe and other places where they're using the sort of conspiracism without the theory that we have described the Trump administration using abroad.
This, Sandra, did you want to add anything?
Yeah, maybe just, I agree with that. I think, you know, what certainly every country has seen their share of conspiracy theories. Nazi Germany was full of anti-Semitic conspiracy theories, obviously, you know, in the 50, 60 years ago. So it's not unique. But what I think Nancy's right, that what you do see now is that the United States scores higher than almost any other country on conspiracy endorsement across a variety of issues. So I think the United States is currently relatively unique in not only the quantity, but also the intensity with which conspiracy theories are being endorsed, if you look at from climate change to QAnon. And that, I think, has to do with the unique political climate of the United States. And the other thing is that conspiracy theories are psychologically linked to magical and superstitious thinking. And so in other countries, there's certainly a lot of magical and superstitious thinking about cause and effect, you know, things that spirits that cure things and so on. And so even though it seems very different from a conspiracy theory, the underlying psychology of misunderstanding cause and effect is actually quite similar in how it operates. And so I would say that maybe you don't see conspiracy theories in the same way in other countries. The you know, thinking patterns that underlie it are not entirely different.
Mm-hmm. This seems like a potentially related question. Someone asks, are people more susceptible to conspiracy thinking when they feel powerless? Sandra?
Well, that used to.
Oh, listen, sorry, Nancy, go ahead.
that used to be a truism. In fact, Hofstadter's book that Sandra quoted assumes that conspiracists are extremists, they're on the fringe, and they're out of power. It's why he saw conspiracism as sort of culturally malignant, but didn't anticipate the political potency that we see today. Well, I'll leave it there.
Yeah, no, I agree. I mean, a lot of empirical studies show that feelings of powerlessness correlate with belief in conspiracy theories, because it typically is the case that people who endorse conspiracy theories tend to feel marginalized and out of power, and conspiracy theories are a way to regain agency and control over what's happening in the world. And so that is a very common explanation for why people endorse them.
But it is ironic that you know, Trump is president, or was president, and his party had power, and conspiracism flourished under those conditions. So it may be that what holds for the followers is not the explanation of what holds for political leadership.
Yeah, that's an interesting point. But even though Trump was in power, he seemed to continuously feel as if he was being marginalized by the media and other actors.
Yeah, the deep state.
The deep state. Conspiracy against him, and so it's interesting, yeah.
Right. Yeah, that was one of the other people I spoke to for that article was Joe Yasinski, and he suggests that, or his research suggests that during Republican administrations in the US, Democrats are more prone to believe in conspiracy theories and vice versa. So the party that's out of power is more prone to believe that there's a conspiracy, which I guess is a way of reassuring yourself that.
But it doesn't, and I think that that's true, that we had in a president someone who had a compromised sense of reality and did think that he was always being embattled. But that doesn't explain, and it maybe it's true that many of his most cultist followers are people who had felt that they were humiliated, that they were losing status in society. But that doesn't explain the fact that you have an entire political party supine to this, and that going along, passing laws and continuing and staking its future on this kind of conspiracy about the opposition being a public enemy and the elections being rigged. It can't be that Mitch McConnell feels that way. So it's more complicated, I think.
Okay. All right. Well, I think we're going to have to leave it there. Thanks again to Nancy and Sander for a really fascinating discussion. And thank you, everyone, for joining us. I'm going to turn this back over to Rachel. And
pleasure.
Yeah.
Thank you.